The text that serves as the basis for our sermon this morning is written in St. Luke chapter 13. We read there verses 10 through 21 in Jesus' name. Please rise in honor of the gospel of our Lord Jesus. It's written. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman who had had a disabling spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not fully straighten herself. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said to her, "Woman, you are freed from your disability." And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight, and she glorified God. But the ruler of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, said to the people, "There are 6 days in which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be healed, and not on the Sabbath day." And the Lord answered him, "You hypocrites! Does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to water it? And ought not this woman, daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day?" As he said these things, all his adversaries were put to shame, and all the people rejoiced at all the glorious things that were done by him. He said, therefore, "What is the kingdom of God like, and to what shall I compare it? It is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his garden, and it grew and became a tree. The birds of the air made nests in its branches." And again he said, "To what shall I compare the kingdom of God? It is like leaven that a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened." So far the word, we pray. Lord God, our Father, you have sent your Son into the world to destroy the works of the devil. Curb the tyranny of the wicked folk. Protect us, graciously preserve us by your Holy Spirit, and grant us finally to obtain everlasting salvation through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. In the name of Jesus, whose touch straightens, and he puts in your mouth a song of praise and thanks to God. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord God made man to stand up straight. Turned outward toward the world and turned upward toward heaven. And this straightness and strength of body was matched with a straightness, so to speak, of heart and soul and mind. Faith with clear thinking and sound godly judgment, which then in turn was matched by well-pleasing good works in the sight of God. Adam was turned outward toward his wife and to whatever family they would have together. And he was turned outward to the work that the Lord had given him to do, outward toward the creatures that the Lord had given him dominion over, and upward, above all, turned upward toward his God, receiving from the Lord and then returning prayer and praise and thanks to him. And on the day of the fall, the Lord God came walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and he found man turned inward upon himself. He found man and wife turning against each other, and everything tending inward and tending downward and bending toward the earth. The woman that we meet in the text for this morning could not stand up straight. Over time, she had bodily bent inward and downward toward the earth. This tending that happened in her body is matched by the problem of sin that we all have. In this way, God made us to look out, but we continually look in with an inward bending selfishness. And it comes out in the way we deal with whoever has a claim on your time, whoever has a claim on your energy. It comes out in the decisions that you make with your money, down to the little things like who gets the last piece of pie. God made us to look up. We continually look downward, away from Him, and away from His words, and from the things that come from Him. Downward also with worry over each next step. It's in the way that we are afraid to miss out, and it's in the way we are afraid to commit ourselves sometimes to almost anything. It's in the way that we fret and scarcely can say thanks to God, pray and praise and give thanks to Him. But then again, how can you? How can you look someone in the eye and give your trust to them after you have betrayed them? This bodily bending toward the earth that was happening to the woman in the text, it happens to all of us over time. Bending inward and bending downward bodily, everything tending toward the earth and leaning toward the grave. It all happens because of sin. The Bible says the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. The promise is something to come from above. The promise is something that only God could do. And the promise was that the crooked will be made straight. And so the Lord Jesus comes with His teaching and with His healing. And when He comes to the house of worship on this Sabbath day, He sees the woman, He sees the crookedness, and He takes pity. And He is filled with compassion. And He is filled with compassion already before you see Him take action. Already He loves her, and already He knows what He has in mind to do. But on her and her suffering and her need to be forgiven, He will answer all of it. And He comes to her, and He adds His word, and He puts His hand on her, and He says, "You are loosed from your infirmity." And then she stood up straight. And immediately she gives praise and glory to God in the person of Christ, who has helped her and has loosed her from all that bound her, body and soul and all. Not only, by the way, the faults that we see and can feel in these fallen bodies of ours, but also, as the psalmist says, "Declare me innocent from hidden faults." That we are natural born unbelievers and lawbreakers and inwardly and downwardly tending people who are loosed from what bound you. Your sins are forgiven you. And that connects with the first of the two parables that the Lord Jesus tells in the text for today. What is the kingdom of God like? And first He makes it like a mustard seed, which a man planted, and it became the largest of trees. And what is that, the parable that the Lord Jesus tells about Himself? Who becomes so small, who makes Himself to be so small and becomes despised and apparently insignificant, who makes Himself the least of all and places Himself beneath us all, and we would think Him stricken by God and smitten by Him and afflicted, and everyone hides their face from Him. and from his awful and shameful and painful way of dying, so bloody. They take him down from the cross and they bury him in the earth, planted in the garden tomb. But it was our sin that he carried, and it was our death that he died, and our punishment that he endured. And when the mustard seed of Christ breaks out of the ground, what does it mean? That his payment for sin was enough, that all men, his payment was enough once and for all, that everyone should find in him life and salvation. And this of all things, the preacher, so to speak, of all people, has a problem with and he opposes. Because you see, this teaching, preaching of Jesus, and the miracles that he performed, they all go hand in hand. And the elder at the synagogue, he doesn't address the woman, because he can't, after all, pin anything on her. He is mad at Jesus, and he takes it out on the people. And so too, the devil, the demons are angry with Jesus, and they lash out at the people. And so the ruler says, you have 6 days to be healed, but not on the Sabbath. And this does not look like rest to me, he says. But the preacher's job, guys, the preacher's job is to apply God's word so as to bring your conscience in conformity with it. That we fear what God says to fear, and that we receive with faith and with thanksgiving the things, the good things that come from him. And the woman that we meet in the text, she is already bent down and crushed. She needs no more law. Or as it says in the writings of Paul, the power of sin is the law. She needs loosing. She needs the release that divine love would provide. And it is the wicked foe who would keep her from it. And so this morning we pray, curb the tyranny of the wicked foe. This we take as the theme for our sermon today. Deliver us from Satan with all of his wiles and with all of the troubles and all the darkness that he brings. Curb it in such a way that whatever he does ends up serving our salvation. Jesus, for his part, Jesus, he says, don't you loose your ox on the Sabbath, the word that he chooses. To loose an ox is the same word that he uses for loosing the woman for her infirmity. It is the same word that he uses for loosing your sins. Don't you loose your ox on the Sabbath, and shouldn't this woman be loosed too? And you see, it is not only, or it is not rather, as if they would accept Jesus, if only he would keep the Sabbath their way. The issue is, it's because of his connection to the Sabbath that they reject him. That he has made the Sabbath for man. And that he is the one who is keeping it. And his keeping of it, not ours, is what saves. And his fulfilling of it, not ours, is what provides us with rest and gives us rest forever. Because after all, Jesus keeps Sabbath better than anybody. He prepares for it better. He rests more perfectly, and he gives to us in himself the Sabbath to end all Sabbaths. On Friday, the sixth day, when God first made man in his own image, Jesus, who is the image of God, and God made man, he came and did his work at the cross. And as the sun went down, the Sabbath began, the dear Lord Jesus rested from it. And no one could guess it by looking at him on cross, by looking at him as he comes down from the cross and is wrapped in linens. No one could guess as they took him into the tomb. He lies in state before all of heaven and earth. But what the Lord Jesus said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Ever since the Lord Jesus puts together the forgiveness of sins with life and salvation, that is the life that you enjoy even now by faith, and the life that will bear fruit in the resurrection to glory, where there will be no more sin in these bodies of ours, and no more pain, and no more corruption, and everything will be made straight, and we will see him face to face. This corresponds, by the way, to the second of the two parables that the Lord Jesus tells in the lesson. What is the kingdom of heaven like? It is like leaven. So the word that you are hearing comes to you from outside of you, and it has all the power within it. Christ has planted his word in you, in your ears and in your hearts, to be in your mind, and it works its way through everything. And in the end, we will see how it was his word that did it all. He changed everything, and we were only receiving. He is teaching you and healing you and saving you as he does his work of baptizing you and instructing you and absolving you and communing you. That is all his hand on you as he is continually turning you outward and upward for a life of praise and thanks to him that begins already even now. And that is nothing but his grace and mercy to you. As you continually hear that your sins are forgiven. And you are loosed from all that bound you. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus our Savior. Amen.